In December of 2018, I sent a letter to FCC Commissioner Carr asking him to cite for me recent scientific studies demonstrating the safety of this technology. What research has been done? Where has it been published and compiled? He has essentially failed to do so and just echoed the general statements of the FDA, which shares regulatory responsibility for cell phones with the FCC. If you go to the FDA website, pretty unsatisfactory. There basically is a cursory and superficial citation to existing scientific data saying, quote, the FDA has urged the cell phone industry to take a number of steps, including support additional research on possible biological effects of radio frequency fields for the type of signal emitted by cell phones. I believe that Americans deserve to know what the health effects are, not to prejudge what scientific studies may show, and they deserve also a commitment to do the research on outstanding questions. So my question for you, particularly Mr. Gillen and Mr. Berry, how much money has the industry committed to supporting additional independent research? I stress independent research. Is that independent research ongoing? Has any been completed? Where can consumers look for it? And we're talking about research on the biological effects of this new technology.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you for your focus on the issue. Safety is paramount, and as you alluded to, we rely on the expert agencies, rely on the findings of the FDA and others as to the requirements to keep all of us safe. There are no industry-backed studies, to my knowledge, right now. Happy to visit with you as to what opportunities you think there needs to be more studies, and we're always for more science. We also rely on what the scientists tell us.
So essentially, the answer to my question, how much money? Zero.
So far, I can only follow up with you, Senator. To my knowledge, there's no active studies being backed by industry today.
So they're really lying about the implementation of this technology. If you look, Councilwoman, if you look at this brochure here, this is from Verizon themselves, and this is regarding their insurance for their wireless devices. And what it says is we do not cover emissions or pollutants emitted by our wireless technology. But what's really interesting about this brochure is they define wireless radiation in all its terms as a pollutant themselves. And they say here they do not cover and they exclude coverage for pollution, the discharge, dispersal, seepage, migration, or escape of pollutants. Pollutants mean any solid, liquid, gaseous, or thermal irritant or contaminant, including smoke, vapor, soot, fumes, acid, alkalines, chemicals, artificially produced electric fields, magnetic fields, electromagnetic fields, sound waves, microwaves, and all artificially produced ionizing or non-ionizing radiation or waste. So what's interesting is they define wireless radiation as a pollutant when it comes to them covering and protecting themselves in terms of liability. But when they want to force it into our communities and blanket our communities with wireless radiation, supposedly it's safe. And I ask you, Councilwoman, that the count that all of the representatives from the wireless industry be asked very specifically to state on the record that this wireless technology is safe for the health and safety of our residents. I want that on record because according to their own printed literature, that's not the case. Are great concerns about this. The only ones who seem to really want 5G are the industry that are going to be benefiting. And how are they going to be benefiting? When they put a transmitter in front of your home, the design is it's going to be collecting data from up to 500 transmitters in your home. And they're going to be selling that data to the highest bidder, like Facebook does. This far, in terms of value, this far surpasses the wireless services themselves. That's why they're willing to spend $300 billion rolling it out. But what it does in the same time is seriously and intimately violate your privacy. The other issue is cybersecurity. With all these transmitters collecting information on us wirelessly, we know that wireless transmissions are easily hacked and there's cybersecurity problems. So you're talking about violating people's privacy in a very intimate way, jeopardizing the cybersecurity of our nation, and exposing us to intense millimeter wave radiation in addition to the current radiation that we have now. And Councilwoman, I think it's very important to understand that with 4G, you're going to be putting these transmitters, which used to be located miles away from people, very close to the home, like here. And those transmissions are designed to travel miles. And the beginning of that trip is going to be going through residents very close by. These 4G transmitters have absolutely no place so close to people's homes. The 5G transmitters, while they're designed for shorter transmissions, you could understand why they would be located closer, but not this close to humans. But the 4G transmitters, and while our studies show that wireless radiation is clearly carcinogenic, neurotoxic, and genotoxic, they only look at one source, and these studies are very carefully designed to only consider one source. But what you're talking about here is now two sources, very strong sources, lower frequencies and higher frequencies, hitting people with a soup of wireless microwave radiation. So our bodies certainly are not designed to adapt to any of this. And the reason why low frequencies and these high frequencies are such a problem is we're electromagnetic. Our cells are electromagnetic. Our cells communicate, reproduce, and transmit electromagnetically. The idea that these billions of waves per second passing through our body are not going to have an effect on us is true fantasy. They absolutely have an effect on us. We are electromagnetic. So is our heart and brain.
Okay, thank you.
People like Joel Moskowitz are concerned and see cell phones as a massive risk factor to public health.
We have no assurance that 5G is safe, for that matter, that 4G is safe. I've only found three studies on 4G. They came out of China, and they all indicated changes in brain function.
And Moskowitz isn't alone. Camilla Reese has spent the last 12 years of her life trying to educate the public on what she sees as a risk greater than climate change.
I've been really amazed at the resistance to learning the truth, the spin that the industry puts out, learning that the exposure guidelines that the FCC uses are totally not protective. Really, I would call them fraudulent.
Right now, the FCC requires that every phone on the market be tested and given a value corresponding to the amount of radiation it emits. It says that value is well below the point at which adverse health effects could occur. But still, these kinds of concerns about health risks, usually cancer associated with cell phones and especially 5G, are everywhere on the internet. Most of us are not radiation scientists, oncologists, or medical physicists, so how do we know what's going on? The International Agency for Research on Cancer, or IARC, is the World Health Organization's cancer agency. Since 1971, it's had a program that convenes groups of experts to look at whether specific things cause cancer. It then defines those things' cancer risks as either definite, probable, possible, uncertain, or not probable. In 2011, as a result of one of those groups, it classified radiofrequency electromagnetic radiation, the kind that comes from cell phones, as possibly carcinogenic.
Thousands of peer-reviewed studies have found biologic and health effects from chronic exposure to non-thermal levels of microwave radiation and low-frequency fields.
There are several thousands of papers altogether that have studied the effects of non-ionizing radiation. There may be a couple of dozen papers that give some indications for a possible carcinogenic effect, but there are not very many studies that give some indications of a possible carcinogenic effect, certainly not thousands. So that's absolutely not true. Most of the studies that have been published do not show any indications at all for a carcinogenic or whatever health effect.
So we've got two people claiming to be experts who have access to the same collection of scientific research. Most of us aren't scientists studying this, so how do we know who to believe? With big, complicated scientific questions, scientific consensus is your best option. If you rely on just one person, you could hear this.
We have some indications from some studies that there might be an association with mobile phone use and an increased risk of brain cancers.
But then also this.
If you look at a possible carcinogenic effect of radiofrequency radiation, I'm more than 99% confident that there is no such effect.